savings dollars and investing dollars. They're, in my opinion, two different things. And I know you had your view of it. When you are making your income from your various streams of income, where do you store your money? So that's gonna be one question that I have for you is, where do you typically store your money until it's ready to be deployed into some kind of investment?
Yeah, good question. So typically when I get money, it goes into a business account, a business bank account that's getting, you know, whatever interest rate banks are paying today, it's not much. Almost immediately, I'm either looking at real estate to buy or stocks to invest it in. So I mentioned, for example, I have about 1.3 million sitting in the stock market today. So a lot of my money is in there. A much smaller portion of my money is in a bank, just because of inflation, the interest rate is trash. Of course, it's important to have a certain amount in the bank in case of emergencies, because if you get sick or, you know, something happens and you need quick money now, it's easy to go to the bank and withdraw it. So that's good. But it's such a small percentage of my portfolio where most of it is in real estate, stocks, or mutual funds. I have $1 million in just one index fund today. It's just, you know, my favorite index fund. I got $1 million in there, and it usually performs at about 10% per year. So yes, I'm not parking money in banks for the long term.
Okay, good. So at least we agree on that topic. Now the question just becomes, where else do we typically store our liquid dollars? Because we've got investment dollars that we don't want to touch because that would interrupt our compounding effect and just the investment itself for potential gains. When we're talking about money that we simply position and have it safely stored somewhere, whether that be in a bank, at our home, in our own vault, some cases, some people keep money under their mattress, in their shoebox, whatever that may be. What I like to talk to people about is, where are we storing our current monies today? Is it safe? Is it liquid? And what rate of return am I getting on those dollars until it's ready to be deployed? So it creates this velocity of money effect. So I want to just reiterate some points here that we've gone over so far, which is whole life insurance, not an investment. In my opinion, with that knowledge, I don't compare the whole life product or financial product in Todd's term to financial products that are considered investments or potentially taxable events. I also separate my understanding of cash flow once I've made money. So here are my numbers. I make roughly a little over $25,000 a month, and my expenses have gone up to roughly $15,000 a month. So I'm cash flowing $10,000 a month, and sometimes higher depending if the number is higher than $25,000. So this is super conservative, and this is factoring in everything that I have going on, personal and business. With this money cash flow, this 10 grand, I then identify a percentage that's going to go towards investing, and then money that I personally save. So I still save money. I just simply change where I'm saving the money to begin with. So I no longer save money in the banks, right? I don't do business in regards, I don't own a savings account unless I have to by the bank. If they require you to have like a savings tied to your checking, typically banks do that. So I just want to compare savings vehicles or saving financial products that exist in the marketplace today, where a big portion of American citizens are storing their money. And maybe between myself and Todd can persuade you, convince you, teach you, show you other locations we can position those dollars effectively. So savings, financial products, right? So I'm combining your terminology and my terminology together. So a saving financial product, typically we got the money market accounts, we've got the savings accounts, and we've got CDs, right? Can you think of anything else that you know of that are liquid? I can pull it out at any given time, other than these three. These are the only ones I know of so far. Money market accounts are like, what, 1%, maybe 2%. And then savings are, you know, 0.1%. And then CDs are probably also 1% to 2% earnings.
Yeah. So like my index fund, for example, is completely liquid. I can pull it out with a click of a button, but it's not considered savings because it's, you know, it's invested in stocks. So it is absolutely liquid. But as far as savings accounts, you covered quite a bit there.
Okay. So with that, when I'm talking to my clients, once I've explained to them policy design, also, I also talk about opportunity costs as well. When we're just looking at a place to position our dollars for a period of time that is safe, tax-free, and liquid are the three main things that a lot of my clients are looking for. And these clients, just so you know, are as low as income of like 30, 40, 50K a year to about 200, maybe 300K in revenue per year. And then I am a part of an agency that works with very, very high net worth individuals in your level, multi-millionaires, and even like ultra high net worth that are doing 80, 100 million a year that have purchased these products. And there's different iterations in terms of terminology. And I'll just give a few for the audience. We have what's called BOLI, bank-owned life insurance. Then there's COLI, corporate-owned life insurance. And then there's TOLI, trust-owned life insurance. And those three, typically, when we start bringing up that terminology, we're dealing with a very, very high net worth individual, family, corporation, typically. When we're in the lower six figures, high five figures, low five figure incomes, that terminology isn't expressed. It's usually just cash value life insurance, whole life, index universal life. In some cases, there's something called premium financing, and some people will look at that as well. But I don't want to veer off too far from the topic and just kind of stick with the main points that we're trying to solve here. Looking at the product itself and kind of determining, is it possible to improve the product itself, the financial product, as you stated? If I can improve the financial product, then it's just a matter of, well, then I just look at the opportunity cost for it. And if I can shorten that time frame, then we might have a case here, a case use where we can get the benefits of both worlds, the protection that whole life has, the tax-free, the liquidity, the safe compounding effect, and then the combination of the real estate, the stocks, index funds, mutual funds, small business, etc. So if we're just looking at savings financial products, we understand these rates are very undesirable, which is why we're living in a time now where between yourself, Todd, myself, and many other financial people that think differently from a Dave Ramsey are saying, hey, you need to get your money out of these locations because it ain't doing nothing for you. Because inflation is what? 6.8%? In reality, it's probably 10 or higher. So if you literally kept your money in the bank, kept saving, because this is what a lot of us are taught, to save our money for multiple years upon end, you would have less purchasing power when you actually go to use those dollars. You can agree with that, right, Todd?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So that's like, this is why you, myself, and us are like, hey, you need to invest your money. You need to increase your income, acquire cash flowing assets that produce income. And then the third component, which I think we might, where we go off, is to wrap the asset. How do you wrap an asset in your opinion? I'll just give you mine. The way I wrap my assets is through whole life insurance. And I guess in your case, it's going to be term. But I guess that's only for a temporary period of time. And at some point, I'm sure you're going to reach a new problem in the world of estate planning and trust and wills and things like that. So for the time being, as a young person, we're both young. You're 29, I'm 25. If I can improve the financial product being whole life to reduce the opportunity cost dramatically and then increase the production, the performance of the dividends, then I might be in a safer, a more ideal location. So coming back to how insurance agents are paid, I said, you know, give an example, if an insurance agent had 100% commissional payout, off the premiums. Look how much money gets paid right up front. That is literally where your money went, right into the agent's pocket. And you have barely anything to show for in cash value. So in order to design the policy to be a little more effective, way more effective for the client, aka you, myself, the insurance agent has to be willing to reduce his commissionable payout dramatically. I'm talking dramatically. To give you an example, here is a real life whole life insurance product that's I personally own, and I am paying in a total of $70,000 a year in principal dollars, and then I have $7,000 that goes to the premium. So 10% of my 70 went to cost of insurance, right? And literally being the whole life component, right? So the insurance agent with this company Guardian, I believe their commissionable payout is a max of, I wanna say 60%, probably higher. So $7,000 times 60%, that's $4,200. If they were to design the policy like this agent did for you, where say it was like a 50-50 split, 35,000 times 60%, his commission is 21,000. And if he went with a smaller life insurance company, like maybe like a Penn Mutual or a Mutual of Omaha or one of these other mutual dividend paying whole life insurance companies that are smaller, the commissionable payouts are a lot higher with smaller life insurance companies. And typically smaller life insurance companies don't provide as much of a dividend performance. Their performance, their actual dividend performance, the internal rate of returns are not as favorable when you work with say like a Mass Mutual, Northwestern, New York Life, or like a Guardian. Their performance tend to be much higher. They're much stronger financial performance, things like that. I don't wanna get into too much into the weeds of that because that can vary in opinion from agent to agent. But what I'm doing right now is probably pissing off a lot of agents because the viewer is gonna be like, holy crap, is that how much money they're able to make? And the answer is yes. And in fact, more if they are the actual broker. They can make way more because of volume and then the higher contracts that get paid out. So an agent has to be willing to take a humongous haircut to design a policy that's more favorable for guys like Todd that strictly love to invest and create cash flow, right? So with that being said, this 70 grand, only 7,000 went to my cost, opportunity cost. Then there's a portion of this 63,000, which purchases term life, because we understand, and you agree, term life is super cheap in the beginning and can become very expensive once it expires. And the idea is that your term life, by the time it expires, you would have created enough assets, cash flowing, where you wouldn't need that, right? So that's typically how it's taught. So what I did with my insurance policy, I took the best of term life and whole life, combined it together in this PUA paid up additions, where it has a blended term rider to it, only for a period of time, roughly say about 7 years, right? If that might go longer, but just about 7 years that term rider will be on. And I've got, at the age of 23, I've got a $4 million death benefit, and my starting cash value day one was roughly about 60,000 and some change, probably like 60,300 or 60,500 day one. And the other thing that in this type of design, typically the first 1 to 3 years with a lot of insurance policies, you can't even borrow from it in the first year. It has to be, it's called the vested period, right? I'm pretty sure you're familiar with that. There's like a vested period. The policy has to cook, has to grow, whatever. Well, with other insurance companies and policy design, I can have access to borrow upwards close to about 90% of the cash value within 10 business days, typically. So within 10 business days, I'm able to borrow up to roughly about 90% of the cash value. There's still a problem here, right? Even if you did all of this, right? Even if you designed it perfectly, you're still running a negative, right? Probably 15% to roughly 20% negative in the first year. The benefit is instead of waiting 13 to 15 years on this end for the policy just to break even in terms of principal dollars going in, with this type of design, we're able to break even typically within the first 4 to 7 years, right? So I pay in 70 grand for about 4 years. By the fourth, fifth, and depending on age and health, it could be as long as 6 or 7. But in my case, because I'm young, super healthy, my policy would break even probably like year 5, probably sooner than that. And depending on the performance, the dividends, the payouts of the company, could be a little sooner. But even with that, you still have that problem of running a negative for the first few years. Your internal rate of return for the life of the policy is probably going to float anywhere between 3 and 4%. And that's still nothing in comparison to your real estate example that you gave and stocks, right? So it's still like, this is where I agree with you. Investing dollars over here is still way more efficient than having just a whole life and not doing that. Because how can you if, you know, when we're dealing with, you know, people's actual income numbers. So in my case, because I'm a high income earner, and my definition of how I separate savings dollars and investing dollars, this $70,000 right here is literally money that I save per year. It comes from out of my savings bucket that was sitting here in these terrible accounts, and I'm moving it into this location, whole life. And then because of the liquidity feature, the safety feature, the tax-free feature, and also understanding that I can't lose money. Once the money is in there, it's gonna grow nothing. It's gonna go nowhere but up forever and ever for as long as I live. I then borrow, and I do exactly what you're doing at the moment. You're doing real estate and stocks. At the moment, I'm personally invested in stocks. I do crypto, I do index funds, but a lot of my money goes right back into my business as a content creator, as a financial consultant, as a lead generation guy, affiliate marketing, network marketing. I actually feed the money back into my business, which solves for the borrowing to offset the interest cost of borrowing. Because I said over here, usually the loan rates are between 5 and 6%. This video won't get posted till about 2022. So in 2022, the rates are actually gonna go lower. They might be like 4% with the new insurance policies that get written in 2022, the loan rates actually dropping, as well as the guarantees of whole life are dropping. So I just wanted to kind of put that out there in case someone's like, wait a minute, my loan rate is much lower than that. Well, that's just because, you know, in 2022, the loan rates dropped.